Welcome, party people, to a new game of the day. This is Michele Lamberti speaking. Today we will look at Queen's Gambit game played by Petrozan against Bertok. Petrozan, as you know, world champion in the 70s. He defeated Botvinnik and he came before Spassky, but he had a reputation for being one of the best positional players. This game here will be... I wanted to show you the other side of Petrosian, because he also was a very, very, very good tactician. And let's start the game. You see d4. You see the Queen's Gambit accepted. With f6 is a so-called short variation, but it's not a... Not an important. He plays e3. You could go here for e4, but he wanted a more positional approach. Black plays e6, and white takes here on c4. We see c5, the usual counter strike against the center, and white just castles and tries to finish his development. Black played b5, and white plays his bishop to b3. Notice that here. C4, the c4 push is not really good. White just plays his bishop to c2 and it's over. It's not over, but these pawns are going nowhere. He will play b3 and a4 and then just crack them open. So he played bishop b7, which is one of the idea of this variation. You want to get your bad bishop on a good diagonal, and here he stands on his best field. We see queen e2 by Petrosian. Again, it's a standard move. Now this is also basically the best place for the white queen. It's e2 or c2. Notice that now he couldn't have played queen c2 because now c4 will win the bishop. Okay, we see knight bd7. White plays his rook to d1. In front of the queen, basically, and here black played his bishop to d6. This is an idea by Smyslov. The reason is that he wants to take one movement later now, because here white rightfully played, he captured with the rook. He could have played also with his knight, bringing the knight on a better field, on a better square. The problem is that now black can play queen to b8, and this is not easy to parry for white. G3 is out of the question, because it wings the square. So basically, you would have to go back, and you're losing a tempo. So this is, and after b4, this is clearly better for black. So this is the reason why white here took with the rook. And now the position is roughly about equal. It's a matter of taste what you want to play. Black played a good move, bishop to c4, c5. And white drops his rook to d3. And now black plays knight to g4, and I mean, you have various ways to react to this. You can play bishop to e3. That's not a problem. But here white had an idea, and he played bishop to g5. And this is a problem with knight to g4, because black would like to play f6, but he can't, because then this this pawn is hanging. And he thought that after queen to b6, where he gets another piece into the attack, that this basically is winning for him, for black. But now Petrosian played his great idea. He played The Bishop to d5. You can take this knight, and basically then the whole game, it's a long variation, and it basically ends in a draw. But here Black played queen to a5. He trusted Petrosian, okay? But let's look what happens if you take. Then you get the check. Okay, so now the king will be forever in the center. You cannot castle anymore. This is the only move. And then comes d6. And good luck in evaluating his position. Yeah, white's threats are tangible. But the problem is, what do you do if Black goes for a counterattack, you know? And basically, Black can also play this move. He can play king to g8. And, okay. Then you get this move here. And this is the problem. The problem is that Blackie has a immense counterplay. And if you get here this check, then it's over. So now basically find a combination to hold the draw, which must be this one. And this is a draw. But again, we are talking about how many moves? 10 moves. With all the counterplay and intermediate moves. And good luck in calculating these moves and finding these moves for Black and for White. So yeah, Petrosian was a little bit more brave, to put it this way. And Black was the first one to blink, and here he played queen to a4, which is not a bad move. A5, he doesn't lose, but now just White gets the initiative. He reinforced f2 and played rook to f1, and we saw rook to c8. And the problem now for Black is that he doesn't get his king out of the center. He can't castle now because this piece would hang, and now you have all these threats against e6. Basically, White wants to sacrifice his pieces here on e6, and this is a very, very powerful setup against the king in the center. Here, I don't believe the assessment of the engine. That says that this is roughly equal. Okay, Black here plays his knight to e5. White takes, Black retakes, and yes, the theme of the game is to keep the king in the center. I mean, if you have the chance to do this by any means necessary. Yeah, because then basically it's game over. Black tries to hold the position. He tries to restrict the influence of the white pieces. Now, yeah, this bishop is blocked, but the kingside attack is still going on. And yeah, Black goes back to work against f2, looking for counterplay, and White just goes for the kingside attack. You know, now this pawn is hanging. The queen is here, free to go to the king side, so Black is not able to get rid of White's initiative. He protects his pawn with rook to g8, and the rook comes back to d3. We're having this battery here, and you know, also threatening rook to d7, you know, coming to the seventh rank. So Black here is in big trouble. Black here tries to occupy here the d7 line, but White is not having it, and he kicks the bishop back. Bishop comes to e4, attacking f2 again, which is basically Black's only lifeline. And yeah, White here just calmly goes back and says, okay, what do you have now after the exchange? Black switches from f2 to g2. He wants to work with mating threats, getting some kind of counterplay. Otherwise, his position would be completely lost. And White now goes for the king side attack with his queen to d4. And yeah, Black here tries to connect his rooks. And white plays rook to e1. Mm. Basically, if this pawn will roll, then it's gonna be over. So the situation here for black is very critical, you know. As soon as this pawn is rolling and these rooks are activated, then it will be over. So he plays f5. The reason is that he wants to get the open g file, so to reinforce the attack on g2. And here you have to be a little bit careful, because if this is move this piece, then you know you would have three pieces against g2. So you have to be here you have to look out a little bit. So he played this beautiful move. He played queen to h3. He wants to reinforce g2, and he wants to keep an eye on e6. As soon as this piece moves, then e6 would be over. And okay, what do you do with this piece? So he reacted to the threat on g2, but he also kept his attack alive. So if you have to defend, then try if you can mix it with some kind of attacking ideas. And this is really, really great technique here by Geller. And black plays f5. He wants to restrict the influence of the white queen. And here he played f3. And this is completely winning now for black, because this piece has to move, and then e6 is falling. So he tries knight to g4, 5 to attack the queen. But Geller just takes. Notice that, of course, this pawn is pinned. And here he played rook to f8. Again, trying to work with threats against the queen. But now comes the attack, and this is over. He takes here. And notice that white basically had four pieces on e6, and it was one piece too many. And as soon as the queen moves, the king moves, then he will lose the queen. So he will lose the queen and the house. So, and here black resigned. There's nothing he can do. Again, he will lose the queen here. So great attacking game by Petrosian. Here he really went for all the weaknesses in black's black's camp, and he kept the king in the center, which always is a great move. He attacked all the weak squares, which was e7, which is funny, because black tried to attack f2 and then g2, but he couldn't do it, and white could do it, just attacking one square and winning. So I mean, I would really urge you to study this game. It's a really, really beautiful game, and the way that he combines attacks and positional play of tactics, a really, really great game here by Joseph. So thank you very much. Bye bye.